Hello, I'm Maruk Said, your microbiology guide. Let's explore in-depth micro techniques and uncover groundbreaking insight together on this educational journey into the fascinating realms of microbes.
Adenoviruses are a class of viruses that cause infections of the gastrointestinal tract, genitalia, and respiratory systems. The virus has around 60 serotypes, segmented into 7 subgroups, ranging from A to G. Adenoviruses are frequently responsible for respiratory illnesses, such as pneumonia, sore throats, and common colds, whereas diarrhea is the most prevalent gastrointestinal illness. Adenoviruses can also result in eye disorders like conjunctivitis and bladder inflammations like cystitis. If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated. A spherical protein shell with 20 equilateral triangle faces, known as an icosahedral capsid, envelops double-stranded linear DNA viruses, or adenoviruses. Furthermore, because the capsid lacks a lipid layer, they are naked. Because each of the 12 vertices of the shell possesses fiber-like projections, their capsid is different from other viruses' capsids. Adenovirus is mostly spread by the fecal-oral pathway and respiratory droplets released while coughing or sneezing. Put more simply, it is contracted by consuming the feces or vomit of a sick person. This may occur if contaminated surfaces are contaminated by flies, if contaminated stool finds its way into agricultural fields or the water supply, or if contaminated stool lands on it and spreads to other areas. The 4 Fs, fluids, fields, flies, and fingers, can be used to sum it up. Consequently, adenovirus may find its way into food and water. 2 less frequent ways of transmission include after receiving an organ donation from a donor who has an adenovirus infection, and from mother to child through the cervical fluid in the birth canal. The virus targets epithelial cells, such as those in the GI, respiratory, or urinary mucosa after entering the body. There, it binds to the Coxsackie adenovirus receptor on cell membranes via its fiber projections. It is able to enter the cells as a result. Once inside, adenoviruses can have several cytopathic or cell-damaging consequences, such as preventing the synthesis of proteins and cellular DNA. This leads to lysis, or the disintegration of the cell membrane, which causes the host to become inflamed. Specifically, inflammatory mediators like histamine and cytokines are released by leukocytes present in the affected tissue. In order to combat the infection, this causes blood vessels in the affected area to widen and become more permeable, enabling more leukocytes and fluid to infiltrate the surrounding tissue. Heat, pain, redness, and swelling are the 4 cardinal indicators of inflammation that result from this. If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated. The effects of an adenovirus infection on the body will differ because various viral serotypes favor different types of epithelial cells. Certain serotypes have a preference for the upper respiratory tract, which can lead to tonsillitis when the tonsils become inflamed, pharyngitis, or infectious rhinitis, often known as the common cold. Pneumonia may result from the infection entering the lower respiratory system. Gastroenteritis is caused by certain serotypes that favor the GI tract's epithelial cells, especially those in the small intestine. Some serotypes are more interested in the urinary system, which can lead to hemorrhagic cystitis, an inflammation of the bladder that is accompanied by blood in the urine. Last but not least, an adenovirus infection can cause conjunctivitis, sometimes known as pink eye, by affecting the conjunctiva, the mucous membrane that covers the inner eyelids and covers the eye. Preauricular lymphadenopathy, or inflammation of the lymph nodes directly where the ear and cheek meet, is also brought on by a specific type adenovirus infection known as epidemic keratoconjunctivitis. This is because the lymph nodes receive fluid that drains from the inner eyelids and conjunctiva. adenovirus is normally restricted to the epithelial cells of the initial infection site, but occasionally it can penetrate the mucosa and disperse, infecting other areas of the body. Now, since the adenovirus is highly resistant and infectious, outbreaks are frequent, and it is simple to spread. It therefore spreads swiftly in confined spaces, like as military barracks, hospitals, childcare centers, and summer camps. It's more frequent among youngsters and military recruits, and it's also more deadly for immunocompromised persons. Many adenovirus infections don't cause any symptoms at all, but when they do, they're generally severe and appear after an incubation period of 2 to 14 days. Symptoms of an upper respiratory infection include fever, sore throat, and runny or congested nose. The symptoms of lower respiratory infections may include chest discomfort, shortness of breath, and coughing. Symptoms of gastrointestinal adenovirus infection include fever, nausea, vomiting, and watery diarrhea. Lower abdominal discomfort, bloody urine, and frequent painful urination are the symptoms of hemorrhagic cystitis. The signs and symptoms of conjunctivitis include photophobia, or sensitivity to light, excessive tearing, and eye irritation, discomfort, and redness. In the case of epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, these symptoms can persist anywhere from a few days to several weeks. Pharyngoconjunctival fever is the medical term for a condition characterized by conjunctivitis, fever, pharyngitis, and inflammation of the neck lymph nodes. A high death rate is associated with complications such as disseminated adenovirus infection, which mostly affects immunocompromised patients and occurs when the virus spreads to numerous organs. If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated. Clinical examination alone is typically sufficient to diagnose an adenovirus infection. Adenovirus-specific viral antigen assays, polymerase chain reaction assays that search for viral DNA, and viral cultures can all be used to confirm the diagnosis in cases of epidemics or severe cases. Thankfully, the majority of adenovirus infections are minor and get well after a few days of rest and plenty of water. Serious situations, such as adenovirus infections in immunocompromised people, may need the use of immunotherapy such as intravenous immune globulin or antivirals such as cidofovir. At last, a live vaccination against adenoviruses exists, but it is restricted to individuals who are very susceptible to contracting the illness, such as military personnel residing in barracks. Children have not yet had the vaccine's safety assessed. Proper water and sanitation facilities, which stop the transmission of fecal-oral disease by fluids, flies, and fields, three of the four Fs, are further preventative measures. Transmission by fingers can be avoided by cleaning hands with antiseptic soap and water and disinfecting surfaces that may have come into touch with respiratory droplets or stools. If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated. Summary, all right. To quickly review, there are over 60 different serotypes of adenoviruses, which are double-stranded linear DNA viruses. When the virus infects epithelial cells, it modifies their structural makeup, causing lysis and ultimately leading to cell death. This also triggers an inflammatory reaction in the host. It can spread by organ donations, cervical fluid, fecal-oral contact, and respiratory droplets. It can impact the gastrointestinal tract, resulting in gastroenteritis, the genitourinary system, creating hemorrhagic cystitis, the eyes, causing conjunctivitis, and the respiratory system, causing pharyngitis, rhinitis, and pneumonia. The affected system determines which symptoms are present. The standard course of treatment is supportive, while immunocompromised patients or those with severe illnesses may also get immunotherapy and antivirals.